as a self-professed geek, I was never very cool in school, and I really wanted to be, but just there wasn't any hope. But Simon Mayo kind of changes that for people. I mean, it's books, and it's science, and it's unbelievably cool. I mean, this guy had somebody killing jelly babies on stage, and there were big controlled explosions, and science is exciting! And yeah, if you like science, and you like geekery stuff, and you like books, check out Itch, link in the doobly-doo. Here's the show.
Now, normally, I work on the radio, I play music for old people. Of which I am one. And if you're under, say, if you're under the age of 13, Radio 2 might not be the most important thing in your life, but we'll get you in the end. Like death and taxes, we are unavoidable. However, a couple of years ago, I found myself in a very unusual position of writing a story. I was as surprised as anybody else to find myself writing a story, but this was the, I thought it was going to be four sides of A4. My son was 10, came back from school, he was really interested in science, and I just finished doing a program on 5 Live, and we had lots of scientists on, so I was getting interested in science as well. And I thought, I'll write a story about a kid who really likes science and doesn't really get anything else. So that's where Itch comes from. Itch is short for Itching a Moth, which is his name. He lives in Cornwall. He's 14. He has no special powers at all. The one thing he likes is science. He doesn't really get on with his friends at school. He doesn't really have many friends, to be perfectly honest. He's just moved to Cornwall. He doesn't speak like his schoolmates. A lot of his schoolmates don't even think of themselves as English. They think of themselves as Cornish. And basically, he doesn't fit in. He has a younger sister, Chloe. He has a cousin called Jacqueline, who's the same age as him. She's 14, and she's known as Jack. So it's Jack and Chloe at the heart of the book. They also, Itch has an older brother called Gabriel, who we don't see very much. And they live with their mum and dad in an ordinary house in Cornwall. He goes to an ordinary school called the Cornwall Academy. He is, however, a collector. And it may well be that we have people here who have, who either do collect things, they have collected things in the past, because collecting things is just fun. And you might have a better collection than the person next to you. Let me show you, we've had, in the last couple of weeks we've had Marmite. We had a kid who collected, had 50 different types of Marmite, 50 different jars of Marmite from around the world. Train tickets, Lego characters, that kind of thing, Pokemon cards, Yu-Gi-Oh cards, that kind of stuff. Anyone, is there, are there any collectors of anything here? Maybe in the past, maybe they're collecting now. Well, just let's just get a random sample. I don't know if we've got any microphones that are up and running at the moment. I just want everyone to be able to hear, just to get a random sample of the kind of things that have been collected. Okay, well, you've got a hand up there, yes?
Mini figures.
Say again?
Mini figures.
Oh, a bit like those? Yeah. Okay, let's get another one, yes?
Skylanders.
What's the best Skylander that you've got in your collection?
Lightning Rod.
Okay, excellent. Can we get one from to the front here? We'll just... Okay, yes.
Lego sets.
Lego sets. What is the best Lego set that you've got?
That's a tough one.
How many have you got?
Around 8 massive ones.
Yes.
I'd say the best is probably my Tie Defender.
Right, excellent. And you, sir, what do you collect?
Stones.
You collect stones? Well, they're kind of free and available, I suppose. How many of your stones collection?
I do.
What's your favourite stone?
Probably the molten lava.
The molten lava. That would be the. I would think that would be the coolest. Well, that's just the hottest thing. you have. Yes, our first girl is a collector. Yes.
Them Lego people.
Them Lego people. You collect those as well. They are very popular, aren't they? Let's just take one more. The girl with her hand up, right in the back. Quite awkward to get to, but I think that's why I chose. Yes.
Stamps.
Okay, so how many stamps do you have in your collection?
No idea.
Roughly. More than 10?
About 80.
About 80. Okay, well, what is your favourite stamp?
Triangle one.
A triangle one. Okay, stamp collectors. There are still stamp collectors. That's fantastic. So people collect all kinds of things, and it's fun, and if you have any spare pocket money, you can buy things, or if you collect stones, you can just help yourself. which is a great thing to collect. Now, Itching of Love, the hero of the book, he's a collector. Let me show you what he collects. Now, this might be the most boring picture you see today. Here it is. There it is. I told you it was boring. Well, it looks as though it's boring. He collects the periodic table. This is the periodic table with a photograph of the guy who put it all together, a really cool-looking guy, don't you think? Dmitri Mendeleev, a Russian scientist from the 19th century. Here it is. This is the periodic table, which is a collection of everything anywhere. Right? You, your parents, this building, your school, Bath, Britain, the universe, is all made out of stuff which is on this table. There is nothing in the universe which isn't on this table. So if it were here, you would say, well, why would you collect anything else? Because if you're collecting this stuff, you're collecting everything that there is in the world and in the universe. 92 of these elements on the periodic table occur naturally on Earth. The remaining ones, there are 118 in total. The rest of them are created, manufactured in labs, and they only survive for a fraction of a second. You might be thinking, this is why would I want to collect any of that? This is pretty dull stuff. Well, you know, let's narrow it down a little bit. So let's take some of the things which are on the periodic table. So, for example, gold. Okay. Anyone want to collect gold? Yes. Current value, $1,082 per ounce. Oh, all of a sudden, well, maybe there's something in this periodic table thing. Also on the periodic table. Tin, fine, that's great. Okay, we can collect some tin. What else do we have on there? We have copper. Okay, these are things which we're all familiar with. Oh, you already have that, yes.
Helium.
Well, that's iron, okay, and helium. Did you mean like that?
Yeah.
Have you seen this before?
Yeah, in balloons.
Oh, yeah, in balloons, yeah. But you haven't been to one of my toys before. Otherwise, you might find it a little dull in place. The thing is, H calls himself an element hunter. This is the genuine name which is given to people who collect things on the periodic table. It's very easy to start a collection, and in the book, he goes around his house and he helps himself to stuff around the house when he starts his periodic table collection. Obviously, if you're going to do something similar, ask your parents. So it's quite easy. So he picks up a frying pan, the Teflon. Here, the Teflon is fluorine. Fluorine's on the periodic table. Cutlery, a lot of cutlery is covered in chromium, which is on the periodic table. If you collect shells, almost as exciting as stones, because they're free, although this one looks a little bit expensive. Calcium is found in shells. All these things can be part of your collection on the periodic table. In the book, he finds his brother's tungsten in the fruit bowl, because his brother does that kind of thing. And most of the jewelry is covered in titanium. That also goes into the collection. So there are a whole bunch of things which you can collect if you want to start your own collection. The periodic table is basically a collection of everything you can drop on your foot. And your foot is largely made of oxygen and carbon. In fact, 3/5 of your body weight is oxygen, in case you're wondering if you're full of gas. So this is the kind of stuff that Itch gets very excited about. He lives in Cornwall. Is there anyone here from Cornwall?
Yeah.
Hey, come on, whereabouts are Cornwall from?
Bath.
Okay, let's put your way around here. The book is set, although I don't actually mention Bude for legal reasons, it's set in Bude, which is up there at the top, North Cornwall. For a number of reasons, I had a whole bunch of holidays there, and it's one of the most beautiful places you can visit. But also the rocks in Cornwall, the whole geology of Cornwall is quite extraordinary. The mining history of Cornwall is actually an integral part of the book, because what comes out of the ground is sort of what the story is about. The history of mining in Cornwall goes back hundreds of years. They've got gold out of Cornwall, in fact there's still gold there. Uranium, they've got arsenic, they've got copper, they've got tin, and it all comes out of the ground in Cornwall. It's a bit of a mystery, the geology of Cornwall, which is why it was an ideal place to set the story. The story is about it being an elephant hunter, and he, in the course of the book, finds some extraordinary rocks. Rocks which have never actually been discovered before. It turns out it's a new element. They are fiercely radioactive, which makes them two things. One, unbelievably dangerous because you can die of radiation poisoning, and the other is extremely valuable because with these rocks, it's basically a nuclear startup kit in the bag. If you have these rocks, you become a nuclear power almost overnight. So governments want to find him, criminals want to find him, terrorists want to find him, his parents want to find him. So he becomes the most hunted boy in the world because he's found these particular rocks. And it's all come out of the ground in Cornwall. He has a collection of stuff. This is quite safe. You've got fluorine, you've got chromium. That's kind of very safe. Each has a few items which are slightly more dangerous. And I'm going to show you a picture of one of them. It might not look dangerous, it's just that it is. It might also look rather boring, which it isn't. Here is the picture. And you're thinking, I didn't come here and spend money to look at a picture of wallpaper. This is particular wallpaper. Is this going to be a home decor question? Yes. Ah, very astute boy. Have you read the book? It's read the book. You're my favourite child. So this, let me just explain for everyone else before they catch up to your speed. So what's your name? Very nice to meet you, Liam. So, this is William Morris wallpaper. It really exists. If you have any in your house, or if your granny's got any in her house, get out quick. In the 19th century, Paris green was the name given to a particular pigment, to a particular colour green, and it was really cool. If you wanted a green painting, or you wanted some green in any kind of paint or anything like that, you'd go for Paris green. The one problem was, as our friend Leo has pointed out, it's made of arsenic. And when arsenic gets damp, it releases a gas called arsine gas. And arsine gas makes you very, very sick, and if you have too much of it, it kills you. And it did do that. So in the winter, when things got damp in the people's houses, it started to steam and it started to make people extremely sick. So itch in the book has some of this wallpaper. It is already damp when he has to take it out of the loft and take it to school. As long as it doesn't get any wetter, he's going to be fine. What he doesn't know is that first period after lunch he has biology, which is going to be in the specially constructed greenhouse that they have, which is going to be damp. So we're going to show you some real rock and roll science, but I wonder what this is. It's not a sample bottle or anything. We're going to do some science experiments in just a moment.